real hot girl shit. And if the beat live, you know Lil Juke made it. Body, yaddy, 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 body crazy curvy, wavy, big titties, little waist. Body crazy curvy, wavy, big titties, little waist. Body, yaddy, 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 yaddy.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Pretty Plus Size and Powerful Podcast. Thank you for joining us on this Friday. What you doing? Let us know what you're doing in the comments. Is you getting ready to go out? Is you laying down after work? Is you cleaning up because it's Friday? Is you making margaritas? What you doing? Ooh, are you sitting too in a glass of wine, watching a movie? What's popping? What y'all doing? Where y'all at?
They sitting here with us.
Period. But I'm just saying, on the other side, like, you know, you set your phone up, you listen to us, and then you know, you take care of everything else. Anywho, we are on episode 81. The road to Ahana. And in case you don't know the annoying voice, I sound real weird today. In case you don't know who I am, and this is your first time joining, I am Aziza, a.k.a. Zeebo, a.k.a. the Human Universe, a.k.a. your favorite fat girl. And about 900 or so miles away, is that long? It's really more like 894. But almost 900 miles away, sitting in her glam room, I got my bestie with me. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hey, y'all. It's your girl, Ruthia, a.k.a. the spoiled one, a.k.a. the real one, a.k.a. the unbothered one, a.k.a. this is my summer body. Period.
Period.
What's gonna be?
My summer body is it might be my favorite at the time. Like, it might be my favorite right now. Like, this is my summer body. The fuck? So, just real random, right? I saw, you know, Facebook be showing you old posts and stuff like that. So, last year on this same day, I had on this same outfit.
I mean, you still can figure that's good.
Right. Right. That mean I didn't gain or lose no weight.
You could have lost, but you can still fit it.
I didn't. And in case you can't tell, I'm trying to hide my fluffy nappy ass hair.
Me too.
Hat from my girl Lo. Nah, it ain't your day. But anywho, we're gonna go ahead and jump right in.
I'm hiding my nephew here too.
Huh?
I said I'm hiding my nephew here too.
You cute. Like, I'm out here looking like Who Shot John. You know what I'm saying?
I slapped her on, literally. Listen, let me tell you something. Nigga still got the edge control right in front of her. Right before
you. Hey, you got the little suit right there and everything. You good. You good. I'm trying to tuck my head down in here in this look. It ain't even a little hat. My head just kidney bean as a bitch.
Mm-hmm.
But anywho, let us stop playing. We're gonna go ahead and jump right in with our quote for the week. And it just so happened that I was writing a quote on my business page on Instagram at Jewels of the Divine. Make sure you follow that. It is actually a lyric from a Jhené Aiko song.
Mm.
Look how the sun shine without our asking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if you don't know the song, it's called Speak, but that kind of just, it was hitting. Like, nigga, the sun light up the whole world every fucking day. Every day. Really, it light up the whole solar system. Every day. And don't ask for permission. So why should we? Why should we have to ask for permission to simply just be? To be great, to be yourself, you know what I'm saying? To just do you, boo. So that's my quote for this week.
That's it. Look
how the sun shines without our asking.
Mm-hmm.
All right, move right along. How was your week? What's your vibe?
So my vibe is the beach day that we had. Did y'all post it? Because, you know, I don't be on Facebook.
I posted a couple pictures of when we was in the water.
Okay, so my vibe is the beach day. It was everything I needed that I did not know I needed. Like, at the right time. Because at first I was like, them helpers did not actually invite me, so whatever, I'm not going. Then it was like, nope, I'm going to crash their party and have an attitude. And I missed y'all. It was like the perfect amount of energy. It wasn't too many people. It was like just enough, the perfect mix. And like the activities that we did was so intentional. And it was like, ooh, I needed that release. Cause I had just actually talked to one of my church friends, and we had our first day back in church on July 4th. And it was kind of like, I thought when I finally got to be able to step foot back into the church, even though it's different, that I will still be able to like release and cry and get it all out. But I didn't. But I got it all out that Monday with you guys. And God was, I felt his spirit. And it was just like, of course, I cracked a couple jokes like, oh, I'm going to put this on my paper. I'm going to do this. And I'm going to do, I mean, I did add my side tooth on there. Don't get this
with me. Manifest your side tooth. You might wait to do that and that bitch done grew out your head.
Not out my head.
This is all your head.
Okay. Okay. But it was just, it was so perfect. Like, I didn't even know, like, the stuff that I was writing down was just coming to me like fire, like, how many papers can I put in here? Like, it was so perfect. And then the releasing was, it was a real release. And that shit tried to test me within hours. Like, mm-hmm. Oh, you said you let that go, but let me see if you really let it go. And I was able to use that moment to be like, I let you go already. I released you already. It no longer bothers me. It no longer pertains to me. I gave it to the paper and the paper to the ocean, and it's done and over with. So I really, really, really enjoyed that. We got to do that again, which means yes. You got to come back.
I'll be back next month. If not the end of this month. It's crazy. I need some frequent flyer miles. You hear me?
Yeah, so that was my vibe. I really enjoyed the company, the snacks, the popsicles.
Yeah.
The plan B
popsicles. Come on, plan B, C, and D.
But yeah, it was, I love the intentional energy that we had and how all of us flowed together.
Yeah.
And it was powerful.
Yeah. So what Ruthie is talking about, we'll give you a little bit more detail because I think that was really significant in our past week anyways. So our good sister who was just on a podcast maybe two episodes ago, El Renee, she simply was like, man, listen, I got plenty swimsuits. Somebody going to get this work. And she's like, I need a beach day. And you know me, I just happened to see it. And I wasn't even at the time planning on being in town. I just simply was like, listen, you can go to this beach, or that beach. Because she was like, I don't want to go, you know, to the main beach that everybody go to. In
that's the lake. That ain't the beach. That's right. The
lakefront. And then I just happened to be in town. So we put together a flyer. We was trying, you know, inviting a few different people. And it turned out just to be a solid five of us. And it was me, Rubia, Mia, and Pansy, and Elle. And when I say it was absolutely a beautiful time. We had good conversation. We did a release by fire ceremony. So we wrote down the things that no longer served us or we wanted removed from our lives, and we burnt that. And then we did a manifest by water ceremony. So we wrote down the things that we want to see coming to our lives. We put them all in a bottle together. Do that thing in the lake. You hear me? Listen. Let me tell you how dope it was. Because when you threw it in the lake, it was a random wind that came and blew on the five of us as we were standing there. And I don't know if nobody else was paying attention to it. But it was like, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. And usually, you know, the water flows toward the shore. Listen, by the time we left and got up, we could see the bottle. Man, the move so far out into the lake, it was just like, okay, okay. And so, yeah, expect, like, I'm open and expecting blessings. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm ready and waiting, arms, mind, and heart wide open. So that was definitely a vibe to be had. My actual vibe this week, though, is my great niece, Devin. She is, like, a big ball of energy and innocence and a little bit of rashness and just cuteness all wrapped in one. She was down here before I came to Milwaukee this past weekend. So she rolled back up there with me. And then her dad was actually coming down here this week. So they here. She back in Atlanta. This is a little traveling baby, okay? She's been in Atlanta like 3-4 times. Like she gets on a plane, honey. Living my best life. But she a little Libra baby. Her birthday October 8th. She 1 year old. It's so funny because she learning words. She got her own attitude, her own personality, and it's such a big personality. The baby don't come down under a level 8. She's loud all the time, running all the time. And we took her to the pool today. Listen, she is so adventurous. She is not scared of that water. And I be having to be in there with her because she ain't she ain't taller than 3 feet, but she thinks she a big girl. And so she calls herself walking over to the other side of the pool. I'm like, Seven, you not tall enough. You think she care? That little girl came over there to play with her. Then she walked back to the other side. So Sam was like, oh, okay, this is what we doing. I'm like, you're not tall enough, baby. But I just love her. Like, if I could approach every day with Seven energy, I would be so much further in life. You feel like that needs to be my goal. Plus, the little girl can eat. She my eating buddy. Every time I'm eating something, she like, bite some. Please.
At least she say please.
And she say thank you too. So but yeah, she's my vibe. She's my forever. She's a whole mood. Okay? A whole mood.
I mean, it's the Libra in her.
Period. I mean, we knew that though. But yes, the meat and potatoes of this episode, right? Let's go ahead and get right into it. Hunty, the question posed today is, have Black women prioritized self-improvement over marriage and family? And I guess let me clarify that. I don't mean taking care of your children or nothing like that. The specific question is, have we prioritized self-improvement over marriage and raising our kids with a husband? So really marriage, love and marriage, kid married with kids, Al Bundy, married with children. So just off top, just answering that question before we dive deep and analyze and all of that. What do you think? Do you think Black women have prioritized self-improvement over marriage?
I think for the most part, yes. Just looking at the way of the world and how self-care and taking care of our mental health and stuff like that has been such a big focus of everybody's, as well as look at the Black woman in entrepreneurship. We're choosing what makes us happy. We're choosing what's going to feel good for us before we choose. I mean, we're still choosing love and marriage, but it's not number one, which I don't feel like that's a bad thing. I think it's okay sometimes to be selfish because I can't give to my children. I can't give to my husband fully if I'm not giving to me first. And I mean, just, we both, I know, personally experienced a man that has been like, oh, well, I like you or I want to be with you, but I can't at this time because I need to get me together. And, you know, as a Black woman, we feel like, oh, you want a brick house? Let me get my bricks over here. Let me help you carry yours. And we're going to build it together. But so often Black men are saying, no, let me do this first. And then I'm going to come back once my house is built. Then I'll come back and ask you to furnish it. Mm-hmm. But as a woman, we've always been the people that's been like, oh, no, you carry the bricks. I'm going to carry the water so we can make sure it's good. It's, you know what I'm saying? We got to have the cement in between. Like, we're thinking about all of the details versus just that one piece. Mm-hmm. So as a woman, that's what we're used to, and that's what society is expecting from us because that's what we do so naturally. I do see us moving to where it's like, okay, get you together. I'm going to get me together. But when my house is bigger than yours and better than yours and more healthier than yours, don't be mad at that as well.
Right. So. Right. Woo, child. Okay. You done said some things. So my short answer. Wait. Pause. Y'all share this video. Okay. Share it to groups. Share it on your page. Make sure y'all comment. We definitely want to hear what y'all have to say about anything that we have to say. Because y'all know we have our opinions. But let us know if we just loud and wrong. Okay.
I'm always right. Can y'all see my shirt? It do say Black Queen, don't it?
Period. But my answer is yes. We are prioritizing self-improvement over marriage and married, you know, married life, married with children. Do I think that's a bad thing? No, I don't. Does it put us behind our counterparts of other races when it comes to married life? Statistically, yes. Yes, it does. I'm gonna read some statistics later on that I, cause you know, I didn't want it to be all opinion. I wanted some facts or some studies. I ain't gonna even call them facts. I wanted some actual evidence behind our claim, and so that we can also take a look at what our role is in marriage rates for our community. What prompted this? It was a conversation with a friend.
You always have a conversation with a friend that ain't me.
Girl is usually the same person. And he just be like, he made me look at stuff differently. But it started out talking about like, oh girl, listen, this is how petty it was. I had to take the garbage out. And I was like, I need a man because I'm sick of taking the garbage out. And I was like, dude, people be married and having marriage proposals and stuff like that. Don't nobody want to marry me. Like, what's wrong with me? And so he was telling me what I can do to, you know, have a man want to marry me. He told me I need to be more feminine or be feminine. Be or get fit. That's it. That's what he told me. He said, be more feminine and get fit.
We did have this conversation.
And so I was kind of like, wait, what do you mean be more feminine? Like, what are you saying? And so it kind of just rolled and rolled and rolled. and then of course I saw a video clip. Y'all make Kevin Samuels so goddamn famous. I saw a video clip, not you, I'm just saying people in general. I saw a video clip of Kevin.
I don't like it.
I don't either. I saw a video clip of Kevin Samuels talking to a woman who, you know, pretty much had her shit together. And his whole thing was like, who the fuck cares? Like, he might as well have said to her, who the fuck cares if you got your shit together? That shit ain't helping you get a man, is it? And so then it's like, how do black women win in life, career, and relationships? How do we win? Because if we don't focus on going and getting that husband and starting that family, if we take time to make ourselves better, I'm going to make sure I'm educated. I'm going to make sure, you know, I'm healed and healthy and I'm doing my self-care. Then you're looked at as you don't want marriage. You know what I'm saying? But then if you focus too much on getting a man, you know, we good for calling them a pick me. Like, boo, like, you, now damn, how much you gonna change yourself to get a man? Like, do you have a thought of your own? Is that what you really like?
I got so many thoughts. So the first thought is, okay, so you're gonna feel this one, right? Because we be all that, right? Mm-hmm. We've both dated a man that said they wanted a woman that can be in a household, mama, stepmama, barefoot, all that. But as well as you got to be the CEO of your own company, you got to be well educated. You like, how can I be at home barefoot and fucking pregnant, taking care of your kids, doing all this other stuff at home or to a child that's not mine, as well as be the CEO of my own company, have another paying job, as well as being educated, as well as, you know what I'm saying, being your standby, your encouragement, your everything. I gotta pray for you, cook for you, fuck on you, even when it ain't good. Like, you want me to be all of these things, and then yet I'm still not good enough? I've been Beyonce. I've been Superwoman. But you gonna tell me that I'm still not good enough, and you're going to drain the color out of me? Close the podcast. It's just like, personally, I feel like the way I'm going to win is by being me. I'm going to get my husband whenever it's time for him to be released, because I do believe in a higher power and a spirit of God and everything like that. So I'm the one that's been getting proposed to and people being like, oh, let's do this. And I'm like, oh, I'm busy this week. but it's kind of like, I'm not doing all of that. And I still somehow be catching some good ones. Like, I don't know. It depends on what the man is trying, who the man is trying to attract, or what he's trying to attract, mm-hmm. and what the woman is doing, and what she's who or what she's trying to attract. Because I can say that I want all of these things, right? But I'm attracting this type of man because I'm showing these type of things. So that's just like saying that, I think we had this conversation before, like, I want to attract a triangle, but I'm a square. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Or mm-hmm. I want to attract bees, but I'm not showing my honey. You know what I'm saying? It's like I'm saying I want this, but I'm doing this and I'm attracting a different type. And that's mm-hmm. the same thing. So he's seeing me. He's saying like, oh, she's showing her honey, or she showed me that she has honey. So now I'm attracted to that. But then you get to know me and it's like, that's not who she is. And it's not to say that I'm faking something. I'm being a pick me, or I'm doing the things that these men are telling me that I need to do in order to attract a good man, a good husband, and have all these things. So yes, I can get the college degree and I can do all of these things to attract a husband, but what if I'm not happy on the inside? What if, okay, I got the husband now what do I do with him?
Right.
Because having all of these things is not going to teach me how to be a wife, how to be a natural caregiver, or all of these things. Like, we need to be authentically us, and we will attract the person that's authentically them, and it's going to automatically, you know what I'm saying, kind of bring those forces together.
Yeah. And then, so this is okay. And I think we've said this on, you know, an episode or 17. Because we had a whole episode on how to date Miss Independent.
That was a fire episode. Y'all go listen to that.
Period. Go find that. That was one of the first ones. So make sure you go listen to that. Still relevant. I'm not even gonna say I think. Black women have evolved since our great grandparents. You know what I'm saying? Like, what we can do, what we choose to do, what we're willing to do has evolved. We are not the same women that our grandmothers, our great grandmothers, not even who our mothers are. And I think far too often we run into men who are the same type of men that our grandfathers, our fathers, and great grandfathers were. Like, so we're at one point in time, just my camera. At one point in time, we was here. A lot of men are still here, and a lot of women are, you know, up here. So, you know what I'm saying? Like, the marriage gap is expanding because we're continuing to grow, and too many men that we encounter are refusing to grow. Mm-hmm. Like, just flat out refusing. It's unfortunate because it leaves us, like, when I read these statistics and these a couple articles later, it's I don't want to say it's shocking, but it's not something to be proud of. But I don't think there's blame to be placed on, it's crazy to say this. I don't think there's blame to be placed on either black men or black women. I think it needs to be a conscious effort between the two of us to increase marriage rates. If marriage is your goal, if having a family and raising children in a two-parent household is your goal, right? I got another question.
Wait, before you get to that question, right?
Okay.
So, where my mind went where you said that we've evolved and they haven't, right? So, a part of me feel like we've evolved, and another part of me feels like we mutated. And that's good and bad, right?
You said
we mutated versus evolving. Some of us didn't, because you have the men that's telling us what they want, and we're trying to be that. And then you have the society is showing us what a man wants and what's attractive, and we're trying to be that. So you have the women that's trying to be the IG models because that's what's on their man's explore page. So that's what they feel like, oh, I gotta be this person. Mm-hmm. Then now you have this era where it's kind of like, no, I want to see you natural. I want to see you in all of your natural beauty, your natural hair. You got men that only like IG models and, oh, her hair is this, and like, none of that is real. She go home and she take all that off, or she was built. And it's kind of like, do we be this person? Do we mutate to be this person where we're the IG model, we're skinny, but then you have these other men, it's kind of like, no, I want to see you natural. Like, I'll fuck an old girl, but I want to marry this one. But then there's that confusion in the middle. Mm-hmm. So do you want the skinny, perfectly built IG model? Do you want this natural BBW or this just natural woman, period? So you have some people who have mutated to what they think men want or what society shows us is what's important. And then you have the woman that's evolved and just like, you know what, fuck all y'all. I'm going to do what makes me happy. And when you think about that, the whole date Miss Independent, you done told me all these things that I'm supposed to be or I'm required to be. And now guess what? I've leveled up. Mm-hmm. So now you no longer measure up to what I need and what I want. Oh, I got to be college educated. I got to be a CEO. I got to be able to wear 6-inch heels while twerking on the stage. Shout out to Cardi B. You feel me? You know what I'm saying? Like, I got to be all of these things. Now you no longer measure up because my guy, what are you doing to measure up to what you're saying that I need to be?
Mm-hmm.
I'm a whole motherfucking superhero. Black women in general, I feel like, are just super human. Like, we make shit happen regardless. And now you telling me that I have to be even more? I'm plus size. I'm already more. Let's be very clear with that.
Listen.
And now you no longer measure up.
You just said something right there. Goodness gracious. That's like the Jasmine Sullivan and her song. Girl like me, like, you gonna make a hoe out of me. Like,
I love that song, by the way.
I do too. I ain't gonna be no hoe no more. You know, that was in my early days, back in my day. but it does. It's like, damn, like, how am I supposed to measure up? Like, I know I'm a good person on the inside. I'm okay with who I am, but if this is something that I desire, okay, maybe I could tweak a little bit here and there, as long as I don't compromise who I am. But far too many of us don't even have, like, it doesn't matter. Like, oh well, I'm gonna compromise who the fuck? I'm gonna compromise everything about myself to make sure that I'm meeting up to some raggedy motherfucking standards. And I'm talking about raggedy at all levels, like. I'm calling all you motherfuckers raggedy, from high value to low value. All you. But so here's my question. Have we lost or forgotten, or no? Never mind. I guess that was I was trying to write stuff down, but I meshed two questions in one. What is the purpose for marriage in the current day?
Somebody in the back.
Yeah. it's almost like
ask me that question again so I can write it down. I'm going to ask somebody that.
What is the purpose for marriage in the current day?
I'm just going to ask them, what's the purpose of marriage?
Listen. Because everybody wants their grandparents, the running conversation, everybody wants their grandparents' marriage or great-grandparents, whoever, you know what I'm saying? But a lot of times, women could not have anything without having a husband. Women couldn't have bank accounts. Women couldn't have or own property. You know what I'm saying? Like, we had to rely on our husbands. You know what I'm saying? For everything. Women barely could have a damn job. So you relying on, like, a husband was your survival kit. Listen, that just shot me straight somewhere else. Because nowadays, right, everybody wants their grandmama and grandpa marriage, but everybody also want to split the bills 50-50.
I'm looking for something to throw. Do you hear me?
But how? You want your grandfather and grandmother married, but like, grandma wasn't doing nothing but having kids. That's why she got about 11, 12 of them.
Don't talk about my granny.
I'm just saying, my granny, well, not my granny. Damn, neither one of my grannies, but we know people who, shit, my grandmother damn near had like 9 siblings.
Listen, so, I used to say that I wanted the marriage that my grandparents had. I've gotten out of that. And even when you just said that, I was like, oh, yeah, me. But I have to remember that I don't want the marriage that they had. Mm-hmm. I want the love and the commitment that they shared and they showed at least their grandchildren. Mm-hmm. Once they got older and they realized, like, okay, this is the one I'm supposed to be fucking with. Like, yeah. I can say who Mr. and I, because I love my grandparents, Mr. and Mrs. Evans was to their children. And I tell my mama all the time, like, you will not tarnish how I view my grandparents, because who they were as grandparents is different than who they were as parents. They evolved together. And I don't know their whole story. I know the story that started on October 9th. You hear me? I know that story because that's where I started. Mm-hmm. And I crave the love and the commitment that they had to each other at that point in their relationship. Mm-hmm. But too often we're not getting to that point. Yeah. I've been to a couple weddings and they do this thing where they say all the married couples on the dance floor and they start yelling out years and markers. And once they yell out your year, it's like, okay, you get to stay. And once they get past your year, you got to go. It's not too many people make it.
Right.
And I'm talking about older people too. Like, our parents are not making it that far. And part of that is our parents ain't putting up with the shit that granddaddy, you know what I'm saying, was doing. But then now you have not even our generation, a generation after us that is losing themselves. And I'm going to just say it clear. They're losing themselves, fighting so hard to be or to get that love, that relationship, because our parents was too busy hustling. And I'm not saying out here on the block, I'm saying hustling, trying to make it, because they were Mrs. Independent. Our generation just redefined what Miss Independent was. Because I feel like I could be Miss Independent and have it all. But the generation behind us now is kind of like, they're getting back to that, oh, I can miss work because I got a man, but then now your man is controlling you. Because now you feel like, well, I'm paying the bills, so now you need me. And that's not okay either. Right. Don't be so complacent in your relationship that you lose you. When that motherfucker pick up all his shit and pack up, he should not be packing up you as well.
Mm-hmm. 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 So, I want to get back to the self-improvement and why self-improvement is putting a pause or pushing back marriage for Black women. And one, I think happiness, right? True happiness is a thing now. Not what somebody told you is happiness. Not what society views as happiness. But being happy within yourself is a real thing. And we get to take advantage of having real happiness. Black women, we might be the pioneers of this shit, honestly. Because I don't think a lot of other women take that stance to make sure that they're happy. They go in and get married and may stay married in relationships where they have happy moments. But overall, I mean, you know what I'm saying? You have overwhelming depression, anxiety, you know what I'm saying? Like, just stress. So I think Black women we have elevated spiritually. And I think we're pioneers of that, because happiness is like a pillar for us. So, and then what that turns into is, if I can be happy and I can improve me, that makes me a better partner. not a piece of property. Too many women in relationships, I think, have been and still are viewed as property. Man and wife. You know what I'm saying? Instead of husband and wife.
Mm-hmm. I caught that when you said that too.
And I think because we're the pioneers of that, it's unfamiliar territory. Nobody else knows how to respond to it, including our Black men. But if I can come into our relationship happy, I can do a whole lot more to make your life easier and happy than I could if I was just getting in it for the sake of, all right, well, I'm supposed to be married. And so now that we're married, let's go ahead and have some kids. Like, we've prioritized spiritual, emotional, mental wellness.
I think we should get rid of the whole mind frame of be his piece. And it's okay to be his piece, but I first need to know how to be my own piece. Mm-hmm. I can't be your piece if I can't be my own piece. I can't be your happiness if I don't know my own happiness. Like, I could be your piece, but that means I have to be at peace first. I can't be your piece and then come up with a bunch of loudness, a bunch of noise. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's okay for us to be the piece. But we got to know what the hell that is. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That, I mean, that's just extremely simple. How can I be something I don't know? And that literally applies to everything. So let me read some I want to read some of these things because statistically, we falling short, babe. We falling short. The United States shows striking racial and ethnic difference. Oh, let me read the source first. The Growing Racial and Ethnic Divide in U.S. Marriage Patterns by R. Kelly Raley. I hate her name. I was reading this like R. Kelly. R. Kelly Raley, Megan M. Sweeney, and Danielle Wandra. The United States shows striking racial and ethnic differences in marriage patterns. Compared to both white and Hispanic women, Black women marry later in life, are less likely to marry at all, and have higher rates of marriage instability. They began by reviewing common explanations for these differences, which first gained momentum in the 1960s. Though patterns of marital instability diverged earlier than patterns of marriage formation. Structural factors, for example, declining employment prospects and rising incarceration rates for unskilled Black men clearly play a role. But they don't fully explain the divergence in marriage patterns. In particular, they don't tell us why we see racial and ethnic differences in marriage across all levels of education, not just among the unskilled. So we're saying, like, you know, even professionals, it's just lower marriage rates. I don't want to read all of this stuff. Today's racial and ethnic differences in children's family experiences are striking. In 2014, 70% of non-Hispanic white children ages 0 to 18 and roughly 59% of Hispanic children were living with both their biological parents. So 70% of white people grew up in a two-parent household. 59% of Hispanic children grew up in a two-parent household. And for Black kids of the same amount, it was only just above a third, so almost 33%.
That's because the white people keep killing us.
I'm goodbye. Goodbye. But I mean, it did say, I mean, incarceration rates and stuff like that. So, and then, I mean, wait a minute. Listen, remind me, hold on. Let me put a pin in that because we got some things to talk about. Since we're here, let's talk about it. Let me find a chart. Oh, young adults in the United States are waiting longer to marry than at any other time in the past century. Women's median age at first marriage currently stands at 27. So on average, women get into their first marriage at age 27 in this time compared to in 1990, women were usually married at least for the first time by 24 and just over 20 in 1955. So over the years, it's taken us, we're waiting longer to get married. In 2013, more than 8 in 10 women in their early 40s were or had ever been married. Racial and ethnic differences in marriages are striking. At median age, at first marriage is roughly 4 years higher for Black than for white women. So Black women, we're not getting married for the first time until about 30, while white women are probably married by 26. At all ages, Black Americans display lower marriage rates than do other racial and ethnic groups. And far lower proportion of Black women have married at least once by 40. The U.S. Census Bureau's American Community Survey for 2008 to 2012, which this was the most recent information I could find. 9 out of 10 white and Asian women had been married by the time they was 40. So 9 out of 10. 8 out of 10 Hispanic women had been married at least once by the time they were 40. 3/4 of American Indian or Native Alaskan women, so 7.5-ish, but less than 2/3 of Black women reported having been married at least once by the same age. So yeah. Those are just some, and this is a really, really long article. So essentially, we getting married later than everybody else, and we're not getting married as much. But again, go ahead.
All I heard you say is that. Wait, I'm echoing.
I don't hear it on my end.
Okay. All I heard you say was that Black women are making sure that we like the person that we're marrying, versus just marrying a motherfucker just because of status, material things, arranged marriages, and so forth. Like, I think I said this recently, and I stand firmly on this. I could be saying that, oh, I'm ready to date, I'm ready to be in a relationship, I'm ready to marry, but I need to make sure I like you first. Mm-hmm. That's step one, okay? I don't give a damn if you already like me. I need to make sure I like you, because I've done that. Like, oh, this person likes me. Cool, I'm here. No, that was young me. That was unhappy me. That was not a full circle me. Now I've learned about self-care and I prioritize my happiness and my peace. And now I understand that I need to first like me and then I need to like you. And because I have a child, I need to make sure your vibe and your energy works with son as well. I'm not just blindly going into anything because I have a young man that is watching everything. And when I say that, I need everybody to hear me. I get that we say that my happiness means so much and they kids, but at the same time, you have children that's committing suicide at a high rate. You have children that are running away, that are becoming prostitutes or what have you. But this is, home should be a safe space for children. Mm-hmm. As well as, let's be very clear, if I have house rules, which I do, if I'm telling son that cleaning up and taking out the garbage and being respectful and holding doors is a thing, why would I allow a man to come into my house, to come into my life, and not expect him to do the same thing? I need to get to know you to make sure you open the doors, you buy me Twinkies because I don't really fuck with flowers or whatever. Like, did you understand that I shouldn't have to tell you to take out the garbage because you are not a grown boy, you are a grown man.
Right.
You see the garbage overflowing, take that shit on out. You are not my 13-year-old child. So I have to make sure, and I think it's important for all of us, to make sure that we like the person that we're getting into these marriages, these relationships, these situationships, these friends, like whatever it is that we're doing, we need to make sure that we like them first.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Because if I like Ziza, shit, we would not be here.
At all.
We so quick to push away friendship with a black woman. I don't mess with black women and I can't get along with them and I don't like them. But where was those same standards when you were sleeping with little stomach ache? Because some of y'all don't know that real pussy pants.
The pissy pants. But no, that is true. It was a Facebook status up recently. Actually, it was screenshots of somebody who said something on Twitter. Same question as polled. Why are marriages not lasting like the age of our grandparents? And a man came on there. He retweeted and then went off. And I wish I could find it. I tried to find it, but I couldn't remember who posted it. But he simply said, he was like, because women are not just marrying to get married. They marrying because they like you. And a lot of you niggas ain't likable.
I like him.
He could have just ended it right there. But I mean, he went on to go on. Like, let's not pretend like grandpa didn't have the house where grandma lived and they was married, but then grandpa also had them other kids up the street and around the corner who you don't even know.
Through the alley on the street. Yeah, I'm spilling my daddy's.
I'm just saying, you know, like, shit, my daddy. My daddy and my mama were never married. You hear me? Like,
well, my mama actually married my daddy. I don't know why though.
Listen.
Oh wait, she told me why. Never mind. That's disgusting.
Girl, nope, don't want to hear it. But like, literally, I think again, I said it this episode. I think black women are pioneers in what marriage is gonna be in the future because I'm not marrying you if I don't like you. I'm not marrying you if my pros don't outweigh the cons. I'm not marrying you if I have more bad days than good days with you. I'm not going to marry you and expect you to change. I'm not going to marry you and then expect for super husband to come out the closet. I'm looking at you for who you are. And I'm going to decide if I want to marry that or not. Mm. I think a problem that we have, which is, I ain't going to even get into it because that's a whole nother episode. Let me reverse a little bit. So, single parent households, right? Unmarried households. They talked about lower job prospects for unskilled labor, and they talked about high incarceration. They didn't say nothing about public assistance, where a lot of people were forced to choose between having a daddy in the house versus being able to have food stamps and low-income housing.
And child care.
Exactly. So what I'm going to do is make sure that I take care of my children, because as a woman, that's what I'm going to do. Unfortunately, the lower job prospect made it so that my man is not a necessity in my household. But I need to still make sure that I feed my kids, house my kids, clothe my kids. So I'm going to take this public assistance, and daddy got to go.
Or daddy got to put all his stuff in a tote when they come and do inspection.
I mean, you already, you know, but we don't tell the business. Nobody's still doing it. You know what I'm saying? Now the inspector's going to be like, what's in them totes? Can you open up them totes? These look like grown men's shoes.
I'm just saying they did it on this Christmas. Remember, she wasn't doing public assistance, but her kids was not or whatever.
Listen, you know we gonna find a way, but a lot of times, you know what I'm saying, you get forced out of the home because of decisions. Oh, let me read this other article, because it was the top four myths about Black marriage. Because, you know, everybody always, we have these general untruths in the Black community, and they spread far and wide. One of the myths is black women don't marry. A Yale University study found that 42% of Black women are married, or that just 42% of Black women are married, and a variety of high profile news networks took that and ran with it. But then two researchers out of Morehouse and Howard University found that when they're citing those numbers, they're talking about women age 18 and up. So of course it's gonna be a lower number, because you including a bunch of girls who don't have marriage on their mind, or won't have marriage on their mind probably for another 4 to 7 years.
They trying to get their
Listen, that's it and that's all. So that number is kind of, that number is skewed. So, I mean, I would say more so do something maybe 25 and up. Actually, split it up and do it in different age ranges. Then it would make more sense. You know what I'm saying? We can find out how often or how much Black women are getting married. Another myth was educated Black women have it harder. Some people say, or it was saying, getting a college degree is the worst thing a Black woman can do if she wants to get married, right? Not exactly. News stories about black marriage often mention that more Black women pursue higher education than Black men by a 2-to-1 ratio. So for every 2 Black women in college, there's 1 Black man, according to some estimates. But then they went and found the same researchers, the one from Howard and the one from Morehouse, HBCU, Black men. 70% of college graduates are actually married by the age of 40. So they telling you that, oh, if you get a degree, you're not going to get married. But actually, 70% of college graduates are married, whereas 60% of high school graduates are married by that age. So it's actually the reverse. Women who are going to college are, Black women who are going to college are married at a higher rate than Black women who don't go or who don't graduate from college.
That's because they find some frat parties.
Yeah, but that's how a lot of women, that's another myth about marriage. You know what I'm saying? We always talk about how other cultures, women go to college to find a husband in the time of getting a degree. Like, get you a degree, but at the same time, go ahead and get you a husband too. And then they said 76% of Black men with a college degree are married by age 40. as opposed to 63% of Black men with just a high school diploma. So again, Black men who go to college are married at a higher rate than Black men who don't go to college. So that's another myth. They were saying rich Black men marry outside of the race. And again, it's not true. They found that 83% of Black men who earned at least $100,000 annually got married to Black women. Because
they were married by Black women.
So, and then 88% of married Black men have Black wives. So Black men are marrying Black women. Black men are getting married. Black women are getting married. And then another myth is Black men don't earn as much as Black women. it says actually Black men are more likely than Black women to bring home at least $75,000 annually. And also double the number of Black men make at least $250,000 a year than Black women. So that's also a myth. Black men are still getting paid more than Black women. Black men remain breadwinners in the Black community. So yeah. And then again, a lot of these things don't account for sexuality. So I don't even want to marry a man. I'm not married because it wasn't until not me personally, but I'm saying a lot of women are not married because until recently they could not marry their partner because same-sex marriage was not a thing. And then you have women who just don't want to get married, period. You also have to account for, you know, non-ethical polygamous relationships. And that means side chicks and dudes with multiple baby mamas that he messing with. And they, you know, they all still messing with him. So you may have some type of relationship structure, but it's not marriage. So.
And then also, some of us are getting out of the mindset of having that business contract with the government.
Yeah.
Like, oh, we married. But we not married to y'all.
Right.
Look at Yandy and Mendeecy. She was like, until that business situation is handled, I can have them coming after my money. So I'm going to be a Harris, but I ain't going to be a Harris until business, because, you know, that's a thing. So you're not going to pay all that I worked hard for. Mm-hmm. I love you. But in order for us to be good, that got to be taken care of.
Yeah. So, I guess we say all of this to say, keep working on you, Black woman. And when the time is right and when the nigga is right, marriage will come to you. Choose wisely.
And don't just choose who's choosing you.
Period. All right, let us know what y'all think. Hopefully, whenever you hear this, share it, invite some people to the conversation, comment, write us, email us. Make sure you're following us on all of the things. Check out our website at www.prettypluspower.com. Follow us on Instagram at prettypluspower. Make sure you are following the Facebook page, Pretty, Plus Size, and Powerful. Join the group of the same name, Pretty Plus Size and Powerful. Make sure y'all get our merch. Don't hide that fupa. Don't hide that fupa. We also still have fat shirts, and we also have the original P3 shirt. So you can get all of that stuff, and we got more stuff coming along soon. Thank you. Somebody said, good show.
I just want everybody to have these conversations within their friend groups, and then tell us what happened. What was y'all comments and stuff like that? Also, be like me. I'm finna go hit Bay up real quick, sir. Answer these questions before I X your ass out.
Listen.
He better answer correctly before he don't mess her up.
And don't be afraid to have a hot girl summer and then go, you know what I'm saying, slut your old man out. Have your man pick you up from your hot girl summer.
Pull them motherfuckers to the side. He knew what he was doing when he came outside with them classic sweatshirts on.
Don't play.
He knew what he was doing when he came outside with them classic sweat shorts, with that motherfucking two little white t-shirt, with them fresh crispy Jordans, with the toxic haircut.
Pushed it. Push them boxer briefs to the side.
Some Ethica drawers and them polo drawers to the side.
Did you say the Ethica drawers? Yeah.
And them polo drawers. Pull them motherfuckers to the back.
And smelling good too. Fellas, make sure you smell good. You win just by smelling good, okay? Don't come out the house without cologne on.
Get that Gucci Guilty. Pay that $90.
Period. Or listen, this is what you do. Fellas, this is what you do. You go to the oil man and get the bootleg version. Put that on first, and then you spray the real stuff on, because when the spray go away, you still smell good. Still smell good. Period. And listen, y'all watch The Wood. Get you some Tic Tacs. Because you got the suck. Never chew. I don't want to smell your lunch on your breath.
Or your herbal essence.
Come on now. Come on now. Get it together. Get it together. Anywho, we about to keep it moving to a little segment we like to call Don't Let This Fluffy Shit Fool. Would you like to go? Go ahead, darling. Go ahead.
So I know my vibe was the beach day. But the steps is my fluffy shit. Listen, it was 9 flights down. We did the, what is it, the whoop-de-whoop, the trail.
Uh-huh.
Halfway up and then 3 flights back up, right? So that's 12 flights of stairs. My calves was hurting up until yesterday, to the point where if I sat down for anything more than 5 minutes, I couldn't completely stand up. I was walking as if, one, I was either constipated or if I was like knock-kneed and pregnant, okay? So first thing waking up in the morning was hell. Sitting down in my computer at work was hell. Like, walking, period, up until yesterday was literally hell. This morning when I woke up from work, I laid in the bed and scratched my legs just a little bit to prepare myself before I hit the floor. I mean, it's still a little tight, but I couldn't be me normally. I enjoyed the beach. I enjoyed the energy. The motherfucking steps can go to hell. I'm getting on somebody back. Somebody pushing me up in a wheelchair. We need an electric scooter. Something like my legs.
Not an electric scooter.
Did you see how I let you feel how tight my calves was, right? I felt like Tina Turner after she whooped Ice ass in the fucking limo. Like how buff she was. That's how my calves was. Like they hurt so bad. Like I'm scratching them right now and I can still feel the tenseness in my muscle, but I was dead ass like, damn, Crystal Nim put up a whole third, you know what I'm saying, audition, and I still can't make it because I can't fucking walk because my legs, they hurt. So to the beach, to the steps, to them 12 flights of stairs and the trail that we walked after. Don't let this fluffy shit fool you, okay? Because I was out of breath. But you had a little chant as we was going up the steps. Ziza, hit him with the chant, bro.
Bitch, you doing a good job, bitch. You doing a good job. Bitch, you doing a good job, bitch. You doing a good job. Bitch, you doing a good job, bitch. You doing a good job.
I cried at the top of them steps, okay?
Legs was on noodle. Noodle.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, my fluffy shit. So, I just got a new phone, right? So, all of these news apps that normally have not been coming to my phone have been coming to my phone. And I was like, you know what? Let me keep up with the news. Let me keep up with the stories that I want to read. So, I just been reading the different different articles that I find interesting. But when I say y'all, it doesn't matter what the article is about. There are some weird ass white people in the comments being racist. Mm-hmm. They find literally a way to be racist about every fucking thing. There was an article about, and I don't know if I talked about it on the last. Did I talk about it on the last show? About the women who, two African women who were running in the, or who were trying out for the Olympics when they did the hormonal testing. They have naturally higher levels of testosterone.
Oh no, you're talking.
They had naturally higher levels of testosterone, so they were eliminated from competing. Yes, eliminated from competing because of their naturally higher levels of testosterone. However, there is a hormone that is more common in whites and Asians that is shown to make you, quote unquote, faster and more athletic, that they don't discriminate against. Okay, I see you. But then just the comment section, like, mind you, this is how you know crazy motherfuckers don't read, because it literally said these are cisgender women, which means they were born women. These motherfuckers, well, if you wanted to, like, pretty much calling them trans and being super, super disrespectful to cis and trans women in the comments. And then I think I read another article following up about Sha'Carri Richardson, who, let me just say, has been phenomenal with taking accountability for her actions in the midst of losing her mother and having a reporter tell her mother passed in the middle of an interview. That's how she found out. Had no clue. So she went, and I'm hearing two different things. She might have smoked, or she might have took an edible. However, she's taking full accountability for her actions and understanding that whatever happens, including her 30-day suspension, I get it. I'm taking that. It is what it is. However, you got a white woman who tested positive for hormones. Tested positive for hormones and told a motherfucker she ate something stupid as hell. It was something like a fish or something. I don't know. It was something random as hell, like, and y'all let that slide. So what y'all saying is Sha'Carri should have lied. Okay, cool. But again, we back to the comments where you got all of these motherfuckers who have zero, like, you don't have no business of your own.
Nope.
And it's like you live each and every day to just be racist on the internet. Fucking weirdo. So, fuck y'all. Don't let this fluffy shit fool you. Anywho, we're moving along because we don't leave you on a down note. We always have to circle back around and bring the positive energy. We're moving on to our segment we like to call Keeping It Cute. Take it away.
So I was a little hurt when I tried to memorize the article. So I believe her name is Purefoy White.
Who?
Purefoy White.
Okay.
I think that's his name. We met her before. I know P3 met her before. So as far as I remember, because I read the article, but I did was like, oh, I know I met this little girl before. So she is currently a 12-year-old Milwaukee girl who is an entrepreneur. And she started her own salad dressing.
Yeah.
So I know we met her. Okay. So I didn't know if her name was Purefoy White or it was another name that I couldn't pronounce that started with a T. But she was so well-mannered when we did meet her. Her business skills and the way she presented herself was super, super amazing and dope. I love the fact that she had this beautiful, big, natural hair. Like she wasn't even focused on being a kid. She was focused on getting the message out that eating healthy can also taste good and not be as expensive. Because when you think about eating healthy, you think about it being either overpriced or it being disgusting. And the parts of the article that I do remember is this business started she was about 6 years old. So her business is now 6 years old. Shouts out to her for that. Her and her mom was cooking together, which she enjoys doing in general. And they were making grilled chicken salads. And she was just saying how, even though they're eating healthy, the salad dressing, either one wasn't tasty or it wasn't as healthy as we think it. Because y'all know Black people, we get that much salad and that much salad dressing.
Yes, you do.
It is what it is. So her goal was to get her own food truck, because she said the only food trucks that you see is the ones with the taco trucks and all the unhealthy stuff. So she said, I wanted to find a tasty, healthier way to present foods to people that look like me, especially children, because kids gonna eat whatever is around, and most likely that's junk food. So she started, her mama didn't think anything of it. She was just like, yeah, whatever. That's a cute idea. But then she kept bringing it up, and she was just like, okay, you might be on to something. So she started her own salad dressing business. And I'm not sure if they already have a food truck, but I do know they are expanding or have expanded since then. And I believe it's called Orange Summer.
Yep.
Yeah. When I say, I noticed her face when I seen the article, and it was just like, I know this little girl. It was just super dope to see that she's still going strong. And she's been mentioned with some of the biggest names. For her to be 12, she out here getting it cracking. Do you hear me?
Yes.
For her to have had this idea when she was 6 years old and now she's 12, that's 6 years of her being committed to the process. And I'm sure there was times where she just wanted to be a kid, but then she also has a great mother and a support system behind her that believes in everything that she's doing, and you know what I'm saying, is pushing for her to be better and greater. So we never know, she might have her own five-star restaurant. I'm putting that in the air, you feel me, by the time she hit 16. Because we keeping it with the sixes. Like, I'm just sprinkling so much joy on this beautiful Black girl. Like, she's from our city, and she doing it. Like, I haven't tasted her salad dressing personally because I'm allergic to all the green leafy stuff. But I'm going to find me some light-skinned lettuce, and I'm going to pour some of her Orange Summer on there. And I did hear from Jay Riley that she has had it and it is extremely good. So I definitely, definitely, definitely want to shout her out for keeping it cute, because as y'all can see, I'm still geeked about it. Like, okay, serious.
Yes. So I looked it up because when you said the salad dressing, I knew exactly who it was. She is on Facebook as Orange Summer. Her mama name is Takara White. Her name is Tanaya Purefoy.
Okay. I tried to piece it together.
So yes, make sure y'all support this baby. Cause don't listen. She gonna be a millionaire.
She's already
6 years in the game. She's gonna touch a million. So shout out to Tanaya Purefoy. Thank you, baby, for keeping it cute.
Listen. I need to go find out where this salad dressing is. I might be able to dip my chicken in it.
She actually is in It says her salad dressing is now at the Freshworks Cafe inside of the Volvo, Jaguar, and Range Rover dealership in Waukesha. So she is getting into places, and I'm guaranteeing you.
I just want to dip my chicken in her sauce. Chicken. Yep. I say the chicken.
That's all right. All right. Y'all know what it is. Time to go to the mirror and say exactly what it is that you need to say to yourself to get you through the week, honey. It is time for the I am statement. Thea, what you am this week?
Okay, so I got to give a backstory.
Okay.
So my I am statement is I am in dare mode. When I say dare mode, I got this from a clip from, why can't I think, Sarah Jake Roberts' daughter. And she said that sometimes having faith is like daring yourself. So I'm daring myself to show up for me every day. I'm daring myself to let go. I'm daring myself to accept the love that's coming towards me. I'm daring myself to allow God to bring the joy that I want. I'm in pure dare mode. I dare me to show up every day. I dare me to not give up. I dare me to be a better mother. I dare me to continue to expect better things. So I'm in dare mode.
Period. Me, I am getting back to the basics. I'm getting back to natural.
You natural. We see it.
I mean, I ain't talking about my hair. But, I mean, I'm just overall just getting back to what keeps me happy, healthy, and wealthy. And that's it. That's all. Like I said in the beginning when we were talking about the beach day, I'm open. My mind, my heart, and my hands are open to all of the blessings. I'm ready to carry them. I'm emptied out, so I'm ready to be full. I'm getting back to the basics. Thank y'all for tuning in to another episode of Pretty Plus Size and Powerful Podcast. This has been episode 81. Make sure y'all go back and listen to episode 80. We talked about drug addiction and overcoming that and the continuous journey that it is. And two episodes ago, we talked about raising black boys from cute to scary. So if you have not listened to any of those, you got some shit to do. You feel me? Go on and make it do what it do. Do your thing. We gonna go on here to get a bottle of you. Bye.
Whatever you do, sis, keep it cute, sis. Leave that beef and shit on roof, Chris, I end up toothless. I've been official my whole life. I bought burners, I ain't buy lights.